Atlantis. Further detail on locating the site. In this episode, I'm going to provide more detail on the site's general location with regards to the Azores Plateau and Plato's dialogues. My original plan for episode 2 was to show more detail of what I'm referring to as the Lost City, but I thought it would make more sense to show further evidence for why the general location of the site matches the description in Plato's dialogues. Firstly, I'm going to show how I located the plain at the centre of the plateau. You may recall from episode 1 that the Lost City is located on a plain at the centre of the island. Looking towards the sea, but in the centre of the whole island, there was a plain which is said to have been the fairest of all plains, and very fertile. If we look at the image of the plateau that I crudely outlined in episode 1, we can try to determine the centre point by drawing a straight line between each side and the opposite corner of the triangle. The point where all three lines cross will crudely show the centre point of the plateau. When we zoom in on the area, we can place the centre point here. This entire region is very mountainous and for the most part would be unsuitable for setting up a civilization, with the exception of two level plains, one approximately 30 kilometers to the east, the other approximately 30 kilometers to the south. The feature resembling the Lost City can be found along the northern edge of the plain to the south. As we transition into the 3D mode, we will begin to zoom in on the plain. Changing the angle of the camera will show that this indeed is a plain. As we zoom in closer, it also becomes clear that this plain is surrounded by mountains, as claimed by Plato in the Critias. The country immediately about and surrounding the city was a level plain, itself surrounded by mountains which descended towards the sea. Zooming out to show the full extent of the plateau, we can place the location of the Lost City here. Now there are three sentences that I've previously quoted, when put together, start to build more of a picture of the topology around the plain. So the first one is, the island was larger than Libya and Asia put together. And we have to remember, this is Asia in the context of 2000 years ago. So much smaller, it's part of the Middle East. So this is a large island, but then the following statement, looking towards the sea, but in the centre of the whole island, there was a plain which is said to have been the fairest of all plains and very fertile. So, a large island, but it's looking towards the sea. This almost seems to contradict itself. There's another statement. The country immediately about and surrounding the city was a level plain, itself surrounded by mountains which descended towards the sea. Again, it's talking about the sea being close to the plain itself, but this is a large island. So if we look in more detail, we'll find something that could actually make sense of all these things and show that they aren't actually a contradiction. Okay, now we're going to look at the bathymetry again in the 3D mode. So this is the location of the Lost City, or the feature that resembles the Lost City. This is the plain. We have this feature here, the Borey Hole. So this, to me, I'm not a geologist, but it looks like a rift basin. So as the plates are spreading apart, the land is rifting, creating a basin, and it looks like it's turning into a rift valley down in this direction. So zooming in, changing the angle of the camera, the floor of this basin is about 700 meters below the height of the Lost City. So could this be the sea? And then leading out through this rift valley, leading out through this channel here, it would take you straight into the Atlantic Ocean. So this could explain how a city at the center of a large island can be accessed via the sea. There's also some interesting detail in the dialogues where it states that the sea becomes impassable. I will quote that properly in a moment. But whatever causes the subsidence, it blocks the sea. It's blocked with mud and becomes impassable. So is all of this something that's, you know, could this be blocking the channel after the initial earthquake before the full subsidence of the plateau itself? And this might be going, you know, to more extremes here, but could this be, this feature have been part of the Princess Alice Bank and subsided during the rifting, blocking off the channel? If we go to another similar feature to the northeast of the Lost City, we have the Vasco Jiu-Sodre Basin, which it looks very similar again, another rift basin going into a rift valley and continuing to rift out here. So potentially, could you imagine the top of this exposed peak, which is today an island, if that had subsided into there during an earthquake, blocking the rift valley? Could that have happened down here in this region? So between the Ecor Bank and the Princess Alice Bank, could there have been subsidence due to an earthquake?
Here are the two relevant points. But afterwards, there occurred violent earthquakes and floods, and in a single day and night of misfortune, all your warlike men in a body sank into the earth, and the island of Atlantis in like manner disappeared in the depths of the sea, for which reason the sea in those parts is impassable and impenetrable, because there is a shoal of mud in the way, and this was caused by the subsidence of the island. The second quote. An island greater in extent than Libya and Asia, and when afterwards sunk by an earthquake, became an impassable barrier of mud to voyagers sailing from, hence to any part of the ocean. Could this rift valley have been blocked for a period before the entire plateau subsided and sank into the ocean?
If we go back into the 3D bathymetry, here again being the Lost City for reference, a couple of slides back, there's a quote saying that the plane descends towards the sea. If we change the camera angle, there's the city. We can see the plane here descends towards the Borei Hole. So that might have been how access was gained to the inland sea from the city. I will show another quote in a moment, referring to the country on the side of the sea being lofty and precipitous. So lofty meaning highly elevated, and precipitous mean it means dangerously steep. I think there's two ways to interpret this. I would argue if we're talking about the plateau as a country, which would refer to this side of the country on the side of the sea being lofty and precipitous. If we take a look at it, and it might take a moment for the 3D to render, but the country is covered with
various mountain ranges that could easily be described as both lofty and precipitous. So this down here is the Bori Hole, which I'm calling the Inland Sea, which goes out through this rift valley. And the lofty and precipitous country on the side of the sea. I think there's also a second way to interpret this. If the country about the sea, could it mean just the countryside or the topology around the sea itself being lofty and precipitous? Well, these are some pretty steep cliffs that are surrounding the Rift Valley and Rift Basin. They're both lofty, being highly elevated. I mean, this particular feature here sits well above the site of the Lost City there. So that's very lofty and precipitous. Well, they're all very dangerously steep with the incline of their sides.
Here is the whole quote for context. I have described the city and the environs of the ancient palace nearly in the words of Solon, and now I must endeavour to represent the nature and arrangement of the rest of the land. The whole country was said by him to be very lofty and precipitous on the side of the sea. But the country immediately about and surrounding the city was a level plain, itself surrounded by mountains which descended towards the sea. Here's some additional information that will align the local geography with the text from the Dialogue of Critias. So this is a creation story. It describes how the city became enclosed within the three canals. So it's a creation story or sort of myth that would predate the metropolis by an unknown period of time. I partially covered this in the previous episode, and I think I misinterpreted this where I said the mountain at a distance of about 50 stadia was later described as a hill. So I've put the full quote in here for context, and I think what it really means is that there's a mountain not particularly high on any side, about 50 stadia away from the hill or the center island of the city. So those are two different things. The center island of the city is the hill, and the mountain is 50 stadia away. And I will show in a moment that there is a mountain or mountain ridge that is the correct distance away. So going back to the quote, looking towards the sea, but in the center of the whole island, there was a plain, which is said to have been the fairest of all plains and very fertile. Near the plain again, and also in the center of the island, at a distance of about 50 stadia, there was a mountain not very high on any side. In this mountain, there dwelt one of the earth-born primeval men of that country, whose name was Evanor, and he had a wife named Lucepi. And they had an only daughter, who was called Cleto. The maiden had already reached womanhood when her father and mother died. Poseidon fell in love with her and had intercourse with her, and breaking the ground, enclosed a hill in which she dwelt all round, making alternate zones of sea and land larger and smaller, encircling one another. There were two of land and three of water, which he turned as with a lathe. So, it almost implies that from the point of view of the creation story, that the geology of the ridges where the canals would later sit already existed, and all that happened was the ground was broken up towards the mountain, so possibly a spring or river or something came out of the mountain and ran down into these ridges and filled them up, and they became the canals.
going back to the 3D bathymetric data, this here being the Lost City, I will change the angle of the camera in a moment so it makes more sense. But this here is a mountain ridge, unnamed. Lots of the other features on the plateau are named. Perhaps we should call it Randall Ridge. It's not particularly high on either side, on any side. It lies about 600 meters above the height of the city. What's interesting, if we remember the previous quote, is that this mountain ridge, again, let's remember, not particularly high on any side, now that I've changed the angle. So this peak lies about 600 meters above the city. But where the ridge starts here, I make that to be approximately 10 kilometers to where the edge of the central island would be here, or the hill in the creation story. So that's about 55 stadia. So it's about the right distance. The fact that it's not particularly high on any side tends to fit in. Some of the other mountains in the region are far higher. So again, this just ties in, and I will show another picture in a moment. It won't be 3D, it will be some additional 2D bathymetry, but it also helps back up the information in the quote. Here's the additional bathymetric data. This comes from the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. This is survey KN161L04. This was done sometime between February and March 2000. This isn't the whole survey, it's a very long survey, so I've just taken this snippet, which happens to go over the northern part of the city. And in the next slide, I will overlay this very crudely using paint to show a more complete picture of the site. So here is the original bathymetry that I've shown. It's a patchwork of various bathymetric data that's been put together. The part that goes directly over the city is from the IFREMA Oceanographic Institution, which is a French oceanographic institution. This was performed in the summer of 1997 on a research vessel. The crew's name was Flores. And the next slide, I will add the Woods Hole data on top. As you can see, it looks like there's some sort of river or canal coming in from where the base of the mountain ridge would terminate. So at the base of Randall Ridge, it looks like a river starts and it actually supplies the water to the city. And on the left hand side, could that be the where the water leaves and feeds other parts of the island? I'll have to go through in another video some of the other details regarding Plato's dialogues, because it goes into more detail regarding how the plains are farmed and managed and how the water is supplied. For the final piece of evidence I'm going to show in this video, I'm going to show two quotes. I'm unsure as how best to interpret them, because to me it seems like it's either saying the outermost canal is 50 stadia from the sea, or it could be 100 stadia. The first quote is, "Leaving the palace and passing out across the three, you come to a wall which began at the sea and went all round. This was everywhere distant 50 stadia from the largest zone or harbour, and enclosed the whole, the ends meeting at the mouth of the channel which led to the sea." So this wall would be a circular wall at 50 stadia, which is 9.25 kilometres if we use the 185 meter stadia, which I will continue to do because that's what it looks like the city is scaled to, which you can see in the previous video. So there's a wall at 50 stadia. But it seems to contradict itself. It says it starts at the sea, but then it meets at the channel which led to the sea. So that seems to contradict itself. But there's a statement later on that says, and beginning from the sea, they bored a canal of 300 feet in width and 100 feet in depth and 50 stadia in length, which they carried through to the outermost zone, making a passage from the sea up to this. So this canal, is that the canal that 50 stadia from the sea to the outermost zone, or is it possibly implying there's a canal that goes to the outer wall? I think the context is unclear. I think I could interpret it as that the outer zone of the city is either 50 or 100 stadia from the outermost zone of the city. So I'll do one more measurement to see how far away it would actually be. So taking the final measurement, the green line represents the distance between the edge of the outermost canal following the descending path to the very edge of the Bori hole. I make it out to be about 23.2 kilometers, which actually turns out to be 125 stadia, so I guess it's closer to the 100. It's still not as accurate as the other descriptions given so far. I've drawn on with the red ellipse the outer wall, which is 50 stadia away from the outermost canal, just for reference. The reason it's an ellipse is because when you use this software to take measurements, you have to use it in the 2D mode. In the 2D mode, it puts a map projection on, so the north and south are not equal to the east and west. So in reality, that would be a circle. I try where I can to generate the 2D pictures using the 3D mode to get rid of any projection, but in the case of measurements, I'm afraid I don't have a choice. Okay, so this is the end of episode 2. This is a good place to stop, as I've covered what I want to cover with regards to comparing the dialogues with the actual location of the plane and the city within the region of the Azores Plateau. In episode 3, I will show my 3D model that I've rendered myself. I can do extra analysis with that. I can take sectional views across it using my CAD software, and I will continue to do a further analysis of the city itself.